Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to it. It's the Daily Daily Caller Podcast for the 4th day of October 2019. It's a Friday. Get your drink on. I'm Derek Hunter. Thank you for listening, telling a friend, spreading the word, sharing on social media, liking, and all that good stuff. As we do every Friday, we bring somebody into our world. We pick their brains. Somebody who has got something to sell and knows things that we don't. This time, it's the double package, the double whammy. Joining me in studio is Jerome Hudson. He's entertainment editor at Breitbart.com, the national spokesman for Project 21, and author of the new big best-selling book, although don't ask the LA Times. 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know. It should be 51. The LA Times doesn't want you to know that this book is selling. Welcome to the show, Jerome.
It's good to be here.
Just so people know what we're talking about. Yes. Do you want to talk, make a joke about that?
I've sold more than the number one book on the New York Times best-selling list. The LA Times put out their best-selling paperback list. It doesn't have a number one.
It starts at number two. We're number two.
So the conspiracies,
I just love that story. I don't like what number one is. Not, we make up our own list. We can just pretend that book doesn't exist. They're pretending number one doesn't exist.
In the era of fake news, I mean, it's nothing is shocking. But to start a bestsellers list at number two.
At number two. There you go. Well, congratulations on all your success that nobody wants anybody to know about, apparently.
I am a national bestseller, though.
There you go. That's all you need. That's all you need. All right. 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know. Before we get into the book itself and some of the content, some of the 50 things, why this book? Why did you write this book? Where'd the idea come from? When you're sitting down thinking of a book, it's part of the process that the editor and publisher asks you is why this book? Why do you want to write? Why did you want to write this book?
Well, you see list books all the time about dieting, exercise, family, raising your kids, but you never really see anything with a political bent, and certainly in the nonfiction world. I think with the election of Donald Trump, the hysteria that the country has been dragged through.
I hadn't noticed.
Largely by the media and the Democrats, and although they're basically one and the same
thing.
I think this new cancel culture, the intellectual meat grinders that are college campuses, I think people, and they have been, the sales have been good. But again, don't ask the LA Times. People were hungry for a primer on politics, something that they could take and it'd be just chock full of facts, bite size. The chapters are all relatively small, but they're really actual issues. They're really relevant and they're really critical. I think, just researching the book, I realized, and you just look at the Pew polls, 6 in 10 Americans believe that the media is telling them the whole truth. 7 in 10 Americans believe that politicians are telling them all the facts. so this is a book, and it is a collection of those facts.
One of the greatest powers that the media has is there's bias in every aspect of it. But the biggest, most powerful one, I think, is the power of omission.
Right.
It's what they leave on the cutting room floor. Before cable news, there really was no, National Review would come out once a month, and maybe you could find out something about a story that had happened 3 weeks earlier
right.
that you didn't know, but it had left the public consciousness. Now, after the advent of talk radio, after the Fairness Doctrine was repealed, then you get Fox News, then you get the internet,
right.
the Daily Caller, your Breitbart. Andrew Breitbart was a good friend of mine. He was a great drudge. There was a way to find out what was on the cutting room floor.
Right.
Yet most Americans still get their news from the main, the big newspaper in town or the top three, the only three broadcast networks. Chapter one in this book is about the number of black babies aborted in New York City.
Right.
This is... You'd think with the left being so proud of abortion and so in favor of it, they're not. But there's an interesting statistic and some data that you've got. I'll leave it to you to describe it.
Sure, no. And your point about omission, you know, about 15% of the book is in notes, which is to say that the data that I got came from the CDC, it came from the FBI. And in that chapter, in chapter one, I mean, it is a New York City Public Health Department survey that started from 2012 to 2016. And so we actually don't even know what the numbers for 2017, 2018 are. Right. But between 2012 and 2016, Derek, more black pregnancies ended in abortion than live birth. Yeah, see that face you made.
It's shocking on so many different levels.
Right. And it's generally the face that anybody makes. Even the people, you know, who live in New York who helped me sort of, you know, edit this book and gear it and steer it and make it what it is. I mean, we're talking about liberal people. They're generally pro-choice, but they were shocked to their core to know that for 5 years straight. And again, you know, the way that the numbers trend, and you know, the book is cool because it is actually a chart of the abortions of the live births. It probably happened in 2017 and 2018.
Right. There's no way there's a massive drop off.
But it was a great jump off. I had this crazy idea that I'd be on Don Lemon's show talking about this book, and you know, him being a black man from the South, being gay, you know, I just thought that we could really have a serious conversation and particularly dive deeply into what is a very serious cultural and pathological problem in the black community. But so far, CNN hasn't reached out.
Phone hasn't ring. You want to check yet? Don? Don?
If you're watching or listening.
You can. I found him. You can find him. Now, when you tell somebody like that, I know what the whirlwind is like when a book comes out.
Right.
It's, you know, on the phone, constantly talking to radio stations you never heard of in cities you didn't know existed.
Right.
No. And you're most of the people haven't read the book that you talk to or haven't even looked at it at all. When you say something like that to the average person who's just, you know, trying to interview you, find out what your book's about, and that comes up, what's the general reaction that you get?
Yeah, it's like what you just did. It's a deep sigh, or, you know, it's a, I don't know if we can curse.
You can do whatever you want.
I mean, there have been some holy shits.
Literally, they took a shit that was holy?
No, and I think
that's a sign of stress, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, like feces has holes.
You know, being black and often making racial jokes to white people just to see them look uncomfortable, I know what the look of cognitive...
Same for me.
I know what the look of cognitive dissonance looks like as soon as it comes over someone's face. And that, I mean, people just turn ghost white. And, you know, look.
Do you think that when you talk to white people about something like that, they kind of go, I shouldn't comment about it at all? I don't know. Can I comment about it? It's like that one Seinfeld episode where Elaine thought she was dating a black guy and he thought he was dating a Hispanic woman, and they're just two white people, and they decided to go to the Gap or whatever. But the side conversations were, are we allowed to be talking about this?
Right.
Do you get that a lot when you give a statistic like that?
It depends. It depends if I know the person, how well I know the person. If they're a complete stranger, they do seem to clam up. I generally assume, you know, I'm a decently looking guy, but the paint job, I assume just would disarm people, you know, but I think generally people don't want to actually disclose the fact that they've donated to Planned Parenthood or that they are not only pro-choice, but just pro-abortion. A fact like this really just gets, look, I wanted to talk about this issue in a way that hasn't really been addressed.
I'd heard an interview with you doing research for this where you said you started this book deliberately with this chapter. Now, when you talk about people who get on, like, oh, geez, I've donated to Planned Parenthood, when they hear that, they're kind of aghast and horrid. It's a testament to the PR machine and the media's ability to shape the narrative and people's opinions, that there are people out there who believe that Planned Parenthood is doing mammograms, that Planned Parenthood is interested in family planning and doing prenatal care.
Here's some condoms and some birth control.
That's basically it. Here, pull out, put this on.
Right.
And if you really need something, if you're going to keep it, go see somebody else. Right. We can give you a referral.
Well, we've got some pamphlets.
Yeah, that's the extent of it. That's sort of one of the things they don't want you to know, the lies by omission, that what Planned Parenthood really is. And chapter one lays that out.
It's, and I even say that, you know, people on the right, good conservatives, we don't actually address or talk about this issue the way that we should. We couch the number of abortions and we peg it to the fact that black people account for 13% of the population. I'm actually using census data. We're talking about childbearing age women. That's the number that the CDC uses between the ages of 15 and 44. That is only, Derek, 3.5 to 4% of the population, accounting for over 35% of the abortions. And so I'm just, it's a jarring chapter because the numbers are so stark. But I do go back and I quote Margaret Sanger. The woman had a program and it was family planning. But it was definitely for the shrinking of the black community.
Well, the progressive movement was founded upon we are elites. We should determine who can reproduce and who should not reproduce. And they were not only elitist based on education and money, but horribly, horribly racist people.
Right. And so I'm painting a picture that this is a plan that was thought of. There was, you know, eugenics. I don't even know if people are reading this, have ever even heard the term eugenics before. But this woman had a plan, and it is a legacy now. There is a longitudinal through line that you can draw from Margaret Sanger, who founded the organization that went on to become Planned Parenthood, and Planned Parenthood facilities all around the country that are just, some of them are just smack dab in the middle of black and Hispanic neighborhoods.
I used to live in Baltimore, right in downtown Baltimore, and there was a big facility right on the west side, big Planned Parenthood facility. I want to just get your take on it. I don't want to go through all 50.
Sure.
Because you got to buy the book.
Right.
Go to Amazon, go to Barnes & Noble, go to wherever.
Give it all away.
Tell me, before we get into this, what was it like, that moment, first time author? I imagine the day it came out, you went into a bookstore.
I actually went with a friend of mine. She's a cop in Tallahassee, Florida. And I did. I don't think I wanted to go by myself. But it is. I mean, you know this.
Right.
It's like, oh, okay, this is.
I was in Manhattan. I didn't know anybody. So I'm in the basement of the Barnes and Noble. There it is. Okay.
Well, actually, it sold out in one Books a Millions in Jacksonville, Florida, where I live. And so I went to the one that had limited availability. You know, there was, you know, I could only think about my mom, who is still celebrating the fact that I graduated high school.
Should you not have? Was there a question?
It was close there.
All right, let's go. America's most deadly and dangerous cities are run by Democrats. It's something that most people who pay attention to politics know. I mean, it's the last Republican mayor 60 years ago in Baltimore. I grew up in Detroit 70 years ago. But it's not something that you would never know if you saw a story about the murder rate in Chicago, for example. They leave that out.
It's what, you know, Mark Thiessen, he did it, but the president said it. It's the low expectation, the soft bigotry
of low
expectations. The media, and this is, I'm writing this at a time, right, when Black Lives Matter is being held up as a civil rights organization, specifically by the New York Times, which probably has the whitest editorial board in all of national media.
Yeah. It's the way I put it is just in general, they're so white that the New York Times editorial board's camouflage in a snowstorm is nudity.
And so I'm writing this chapter at a time where these people are marching up and down the streets talking about the value of black life. And so in some of these chapters, there's sort of a racial element to it. And not once, I mean, they're protesting police who 99.99% of these people wake up every day not wanting to shoot an unarmed black person, but to protect
that's not the community. I've seen NBC News.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the thesis of the book. If you watch the mainstream media, there's a lot you wouldn't know. But they're castigating the police as racist, and I talked to so many cops writing several of these chapters, but particularly this one. And so I wanted to make the point that these cities that are being choked off, and I mean are darkened by just a miasma of crime, and not just shootings, although there are just devastating numbers of black-on-black death and in crime, but I mean violent crimes. These cities are largely the ones that we don't hear about. I mean, Baltimore, I have a brother who lives there, and I actually, when I start talking about the crime in Baltimore, I see this headline and it says the first shooting death that happens in Baltimore happens literally minutes after the bell dropped on January 1. Look, it's something that conservatives certainly write and talk about a lot. But I wanted the chapter, I wanted the words to jump off the page. A lot of the writing, it's from the standpoint of the human misery that is actually happening in these communities. And the point that's made is, why are people standing for it on a micro level in the communities? But certainly, why isn't the media reporting it on a national scale?
Do you find that even when you talk to conservatives, white conservatives, like evil white conservatives, I don't know any of them personally, but right. I hear bad things. And it just occurred to me, conservatives do, from what you said, conservatives do certainly draw attention to what's going on in Baltimore, Detroit, Chicago,
right.
Constantly. But does it matter why they're doing it? Because it almost seems, and I guess I'm kind of guilty of it too. And we bring it up as saying, look at what you guys are. You guys suck. Look at what's happening in your cities.
Right.
I don't know that there's a lot of concern from a lot of the people who are bringing up the horrible situations in the south side of Chicago, right. Or the west side of Baltimore.
Well, that's probably a whole nother book.
I know.
And I get this. I'm asked this because I am black.
What?
If you can tell. Yeah. And I tell people, look,
Richie, why don't you tell me these things?
I just happen to be conservative.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, me not being a sideline spectator, I was held at gunpoint in December 2001 mm-hmm. in broad daylight, a few blocks from the home that I grew up in Savannah, Georgia, by a man that I went to middle school with. And I said his name because he didn't have a mask on. He should have blown me away right there, but I don't even think the thing was loaded. But, I mean, he robbed me. He mm-hmm. was serious and intent on taking money from me. Now, I grew up in a middle-class neighborhood. Mm-hmm. You know, Savannah is probably one of those cities that hasn't elected a mayor in decades, a Republican mayor in decades. But people, when people ask me this, I tell them this story. You know, I find myself having to defend the fact that the RNC doesn't really come off as if they care about the plight and the bloodshed and the violence that we're talking about.
That they use it more as a political weapon than
right.
they actually care about.
I don't even think that they use it in terms of a political bludgeon in the right way, which is to say, what Donald Trump did, right, when he's given that stump speech I think he was in South Carolina in the black church, he's saying, what the hell do you have to lose?
Mm-hmm.
I don't even hear national Republicans or congressional Republicans or mayors or commissioners who are conservative arguing, look, you've allowed this to happen. You have. You've voted for these people. You have not held them accountable. It would be nice for, you know, Republicans seeking elected office to actually articulate that you've tried this for so long. These Democrats who you've elected, their lives have gotten better, but yours has either remained stagnant or has gotten worse. It'd be nice to hear them go into these communities the way that Trump did, and argue for just a different way, a better way, something different, because it honestly, in so many of these blighted communities, can't get worse.
No, I know. I grew up, like I said, in Detroit, watched John Conyers' district. You can see where he's gone now.
I have a brother that lives harassment. In Baltimore, yeah.
But John Conyers was there for 50-some-odd years, and you can see the shell of what used to be the district.
Right.
The empty buildings, and you thought that building 40 years ago looked really nice.
Darkened communities.
it happens over time, and people keep reelecting the same thing. When I was in Baltimore, the mayor resigned, then another mayor resigned, and the city council had 50% turnover. And I thought, maybe we get some new blood in there. But they elected different people with the same ideology, right, and you get the same results. Do you see any possibility of that changing anytime soon? Or is it Democrats, the black vote, Democrats to lose or Republicans to win, or neither apply?
It's always been Republicans to win. You know, it's so easy, right? So I was writing for Human Events in 2010, and I was writing about the carnage in black communities that exists in Democrat congressional districts. Mm-hmm. And I came across this audit that, believe it or not, the Congressional Black Caucus did in 2015. And in the audit, at that time, it was about 49 districts. For each Congressional Black Caucus district, that district was about four or five numbers above the poverty line. About four or five numbers. I think the average, the poverty line was at 14%. Mm-hmm. So at least 19% for every. And I was just looking at Sheila Jackson Lee's, and it was like 23%. And so, I say that to say that the argument is easy to make. I mean, just for decades, these people have failed their constituencies. But if Republicans aren't making the argument, if they aren't willing to do it, and I mean, just, you don't even have to spend a bunch of money.
You can just try it.
Yeah,
that'd be a novel start. Now, you're the entertainment editor at Breitbart, so this book is not all about the two chapters that we've discussed so far. I'll let you pick another one. Go ahead and tell us one of the 50 things that they don't want us to know, but we should know.
You said entertainment, but another one that elicits a response of shock is that a majority of our Border Patrol agents are Hispanic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was—
horrible racist against Hispanics.
Right.
Wait, what? Never mind.
And so when I tell people that, it's usually after Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez has compared, you know, Border Patrol to Nazis. And they're smart enough not to come out and say this. They'll invoke Auschwitz or concentration camps. Mm. But we get the game. And I wanted to make that point salient because it was an easy way for me to write other chapters that Princeton Advisors estimates that this year over 100,000 women and girls will be raped or sexually assaulted, making the trip from Central America to the U.S. border. It allowed me to write that in just a decade, over half of federal arrests are immigration related. 1.2 million identity thefts committed by illegal immigrants. And so you write a chapter and you're writing about how the majority of the people who are defending the border are actually Hispanic. Well, it makes sense. They speak the language, right, with people that they're going to be coming in contact with. But you see Democrats and even the media constantly castigating the Trump administration and their immigration policies as racist. I realize why people are so shocked by it. But again, that's the reason I wrote the book, is because, I mean, the web of disinformation out there is just, I mean, it's so awful. Like, people have no idea. And this was just basically a government audit done by the Department of Homeland Security that I was lucky enough to be trained by Peter Schweitzer to be a sleuth to find these things. But, I mean, it was buried deep.
That's the perfect term for it, the web of misinformation. The webs have a lot of space between the things, and you're filling in a lot of the gaps here. One of the things that happens when you write a book is you have notions going in. I bet you had a list of probably 75 things. A
lot of cutting room floor.
Or if not more. And while doing the research or whatever to back up or make the point or discover things, you learn something.
Right.
The reader's always going to learn something. I'm curious, what did you learn while writing this book about the book?
Sure. No. So the book, the title of the chapter is There Are No Jobs Americans Won't Do. Mm-hmm. you've heard, and thanks to South Park, it has become just a part of the pop cultural fabric. They took our jobs. People believe that the men and women illegally immigrating to America fill the jobs. So you think about just menial labor job. Am I saying that right?
Menial. Well, there's menial jobs and manual labor jobs.
Right.
Menial Both jobs can be like sorting for all day.
Sure.
And manual labor jobs would be carrying the big bins of the sorted paper.
So hospitality. You go to a hotel. Oftentimes you are going to see someone who is probably of Hispanic or Latino descent. But 58.
You're such a racist.
I know, but this is just this is just the Department of Labor, and it's actually funny. My editor is like, "You realize 15% of your book is in notes?" I was like, "Yeah, it's a lot of pages."
That bolsters the argument.
But this is the Department of Labor basically doing annual audits. I mean, in the major farming, it's 56% are native born people holding down those jobs. You think about hospitality in a hotel, the waiting staff, the maids, generally the people you see and you automatically think would be immigrants holding down those jobs. The majority of those jobs are being held by Americans. And I always was skeptical about, the idea or the notion that all of these jobs are just being taken by immigrants, right. Particularly in the farming.
Farming is everything sector. That's not automated is done right. By illegals who come in for seasonal work and then they leave. That's right. What we're told because it's backbreaking and Americans won't do it.
Right. But the data is there for anybody who's willing to look. And it's always used as a sort of wedge issue argument in terms of, you don't want these people here, but Americans just won't do these jobs. I mean, that's literally what is said on the stump in during political seasons. Well, Americans won't do these jobs. These are the jobs that Americans won't do. And again, I wanted to point that out. And it's there are great charts and graphs for people who don't like to read a whole lot of numbers and mm-hmm. and words, but it's not pictures, but it's there for you.
You're a black guy.
Yeah.
Okay, I waited until you were sitting down.
Milk chocolate
American. I waited for you to be sitting down before breaking this news to you. And I imagine a lot of guys you grew up with, a lot of friends, family members,
right.
Don't necessarily share your politics.
Yeah, I write about this in the introduction because I realize that it's the first thing that people are going to read if they didn't skip it and just mm-hmm. go straight to one of their favorite chapters. I wanted to paint a picture for people that I wasn't always conservative mm-hmm. because when you're born black, you're born a Democrat. It's an old saying.
Nobody's perfect.
But being on a college campus, being amongst peers, and sitting in classrooms and sort of hearing things that it just didn't jive well. And then meeting a professor who became a mentor and being given books by, Thomas Sowell and just great authors.
Thomas Sowell gave you books?
No, but...
I know what you meant.
I wish. Wow, that'd be a great honor. But no. And so I talk about the political awakening that I had in my early 20s and the cost that I had to pay socially for believing the things that I believe that were against the orthodoxy on the left and sort of losing the ability to have this sort of social validation that a 20-year-old college kid would want. But my family had always been supportive of me because, as I do in the book, like if I'm speaking about an issue, like I'm backing up with facts. I'm not just pulling, arguments out of my butt. It's always been good to have the support of my family, of my colleagues, and of my friends. I'm free. When I'm talking to people, I tell them that, I like hanging around conservatives because they don't automatically make the assumptions that because I'm black, I voted for this guy or I support this policy. I come to the table, literally this table with you, and there isn't that intellectual bargain that goes on. You, Derek, you just say, "Oh, well, this guy's very interesting." You don't make those assumptions, and so. You know, again, it's I was called the conservative Kanye West. This was a decade ago.
You didn't walk in with a Kim and you didn't fly private. So I would not call you that. Let me ask you, Jerome. Yeah. This book, it's filled with ammunition for conservatives. It fills in a lot of gaps of things that you've heard, you know, a little bit, but it gives a lot more meat on the bone for your discussions with your liberal friends. But if you were to hand this to a liberal professor, the most liberal professor you've ever had. So mm-hmm. Go ahead and pick whichever one of that is in your mind. And they had to read it cover to cover and believe it as gospel truth, not get the little hamster in their head running around going, well, Rachel Maddow said something different to this. But what would shock them the most? What do you think that a committed liberal who just happened upon this and read it, they close the last page and they go, holy crap, number 42. I didn't even know that. Or which one's going to – the biggest shock. It'll all shock them because they live in a sort of siloed society. But the biggest shock out there.
Yeah, no, sure. I think the fact that illegal immigration has cost black Americans over 1 million jobs in the last decade, I think
– but it's a boon to the economy. I've read right. The New York Times.
You know, again, this is one of those issues in which the Democrats have moved on. They've taken the black vote, if you will, as just a given, and rightfully so. I mean, black people are the most dedicated, monolithic voters.
Except for white Massachusetts to Kennedy's. they actually get 97% of the white people.
You don't even have to be
related
to the lineage, you last names, just be Kennedy. And black women particularly are the most strident Democratic voters. But you've heard or you've seen Barack Obama write about this in his book Audacity of Hope. He talks about how illegal immigration depresses the labor market, particularly for black workers. I remember hearing Bernie Sanders speak vociferously about this. And so, you know, Democrats moved on over a decade ago and started to just openly court the Hispanic vote. But this is the disastrous result of open borders and a naked pro-immigration or turning your back on illegal immigration. You're devastating an entire community that you, Professor English, was that most liberal professor's name. This is the disastrous result. I mean, it has you've destroyed people's lives, and for what?
When they sip their chai tea at night, they feel morally superior to everybody else. That's what it's all about.
And I mean, the people coming to this country, obviously they're leaving a situation that they think is so bad that they have to just risk life and limb to come here. And they're also just horrific victims. And you never actually hear Democrats and liberals articulate that human misery side of it. It's like these people are being paid.
Well, in many ways, they inspire these people to come. So, you know, it's like storming the beaches at Normandy. 90% of you are going to get shot. The 10% will get through, and then we'll take the beachhead.
There are other ones, though.
Horrible things happen.
That I just remembered. So in the chapter where I talk about how Barack Obama deported more illegal immigrants than any president, all presidents combined in the 20th century. There was a program that started. It was initiated in February 2008, but the Bush administration rarely used it. It basically, in the Obama administration, ramped it up. Jay Johnson, real hero of the immigrant people, basically. if a family came across the border and was apprehended, this program initiated and was played out in such that the male would be separated from the women and children. He'd be put on a bus right there and driven about 50 miles into Texas, and then put on a plane. And then the plane would be filled up. And then that plane would fly 1,000 miles away from the original point of entry. And then those male illegal immigrants would be hauled back over the border, 1,000 miles away from... And so
it sounds horribly compassionate.
Right. This was carried out thousands of times between 2012 and the end of Obama's presidency. I'd never actually heard of the lateral replacement program. It's a weird technical name for it. But the ACLU sued the Obama administration. They called it cruel and unusual. And I mean, that is exactly what would happen.
Sounds
to
worse than my trebuchet.
Now, that's not
Mexico
family
idea.
Separation.
No kidding. That's what some serious mileage.
I don't know what is, but no, this thing is chocked full of so much.
Last thing they don't want you to know about. I know it's in here, mm-hmm. and I know it's something that a lot of Americans care about, guns. What is right. something they don't want you to know, us to know about guns?
I'm talking in 78 years. This data is based on Dr. John Lott's research from 1950.
Who sat in that very chair not that long ago.
From 1950 to last year, over 97% of mass shootings occurred in what are basically advertised gun-free zones. It's the kind of thing that would make you, if you're a parent, as you are, you just pause and think, well, why the hell am I sending my child to a place? Or again, you're advertising for someone who would carry out an evil act. Yep, there are no guns here. It would automatically
kind of like
be
your bank
the number
advertising.
One
target. We just throw your money on the floor and kind of watch it. And of course, people are going to go in there and take some money. And that would be, if you're looking for cash, that's the way to go. If you're looking for a defenseless population, you go to places where people are mandatorily defenseless.
Right. And it's one of those things that I guess really kind of presses you up against a concrete reality that this country, I mean, you hear Beto O'Rourke talking about he's gonna take your AR-15 and like, well, first of all, you're not gonna do that.
Right.
But secondly, these heinous acts oftentimes are being committed by people holding handguns. Mm-hmm. And it you can't have a serious conversation with them if they don't want to actually address this issue. And there are so many capable and well-qualified people, particularly veterans or retired police officers, who could just walk these halls, just take the stupid signs down off of movie theaters, off of schools, off of college campuses. Just stop. If you don't want to arm the teachers, if you don't want to invest in, you know, the resources that it would take to do that, just give the people who we sent to protect the country or to protect your community and allow them to protect your kids.
You also don't need the defenseless zone signs.
Well, take the signs down. You know, right?
Like, take the come sign. On in, we're defenseless, and we carry lots of cash.
Yeah.
Come on in, the water's fine.
Doors are open.
Doesn't make any sense. Jerome has been nice enough to sign these books, so if you want to enter to win one of three signed copies of the book, you got to email derek@dailycaller.com. If you've purchased a book or are to purchase a book, here's the deal. If you got one already, take a picture of it with you, not in a bookstore. I ain't buying that.
Hold up the newspaper.
Email it to me. There you go. Do it like a hostage photo. If you buy one now until next Thursday, if you have one already, you get entered twice. If you buy one now after being inspired by this interview, I'll enter you three times, depending as long as your email shows the date on the receipt. Otherwise, you get entered once. So it's all for free. Congratulations on the
book. Thank you.
The Los Angeles Times called.
I may be number one, but yeah. They actually didn't publish the number one.
They congratulated you on. The site is Breitbart.com. The book, 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know. The man is Jerome Hudson. The project is Project 21, where he's national spokesman. All of that stuff and all this knowledge in one book. Go out and buy it. Be back here on Monday. Have a great weekend.